Thank you, Dorina. Good morning. A very good morning to my honored speakers here together with me in the front and also to all participants. So our session here is Social Cohesion, Living Through the Historical Context of a Nation. We have three speakers, all from various backgrounds, but all share one common theme, that is justice, equality and peace. When we talk about social cohesion, so the thing that comes to our mind is nation. Nation building, the making of a nation. So what is this nation that we have in mind? What is the nation of intent? And three speakers here, we are going to share this journey. Malaysia as well as UK, the UK journey, as well as the Malaysian journey in our quest to create or build or make a nation. So it's just like baking a cake. We want to bake a cake, we have to know what is the cake that we want to make. What is the product? What is this nation of intent that we want to make? And we have to have the ingredients, and we have to have the producer, the maker, or the baker. Just now, Dato Shamsul, he said about history is very important. But whose history are we talking about? Whose version of history? We have his story, we have her story, or is it our story? A very engaging and inclusive history that includes everybody who has played a very significant role in the making of our nation, or the nation to be. So this concept, the time dimension as well as space dimension, is very important because we would not know where we are going. Yes, of course, we would not know where we are going if we don't know the present. But more so, if we don't know the present and we don't know the future, we don't know where we come from. So the past, present and future, there's got to be a bridge between these three dimensions. And so here to share with us the Malaysian journey, we have two very important people. They are always in the news, whether in the mainstream news or the alternative media. First is Professor Dr. Abdul Aziz Bari. Here, the first time we received the program is he's a constitutional expert. Now here, the purple color is the Penang Institute. Yes, Prof. Aziz is a senior fellow at with Penang Institute, but allow me to just read his brief biodata. Of course, his biodata will be very, very short, very long, but here is only a few sentences only. Dr. Aziz is an outspoken scholar. First, a law professor, and a very outspoken scholar, I would add the very there, and an expert in the field of constitutional law. He was appointed to UNICEL in 2013, and was formerly a lecturer at University, at International Islamic University of Malaysia, and we know why was formerly and not now still. From 1989 to 2011. He is the author of Malaysian Constitution, A Critical Introduction, and the Monarchy and the Institution in Malaysia. If I may add, he was also the PKR candidate for Sabah Bernam, Perak, back in PRU 13, 2012. So here we have a PKR, and over in the middle there we have the PAS. Very good. Then we...
We don't have UMNO, yes.
So moving on, our second speaker, all the way from UK, to share with us the UK journey, is Mr. Paul Giannasi. Paul is from the UK Ministry of Justice Hate Crime Programme. And he's a police superintendent working within the Ministry of Justice in the United Kingdom. He leads a cross-governmental hate crime programme, which brings all sectors of government together to coordinate efforts to improve the response to hate crimes from all across the criminal justice system. So bear in mind that these hate crimes, is, even though we talk about race relations, but back in UK, it's not just race relations, it's very inclusive. It includes the disability, disabled people, it includes the LGBTs also, yeah? National minorities as well as migrants. So it's not just about racism. Paul is also the UK national point of contact to the Office of Democratic Institutions and Human Rights on hate crime, and has worked to share good practice within the OSCE, that is the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe region and within Africa. Paul is also a member of the Association of Chief Police Officers Hate Crime Group and is coordinating the refresh of ACPO Hate Crime Manual, which will guide all UK police officers and partners. So Paul will share with us hate crimes, the UK journey. Moving on, our third speaker, last but not least, is Yang Berhormat, Dr. Mujahid Yusof Rawa. And I just got to know this just 5 seconds ago that YB Mujahid is the good friend of my younger sister back in Multimedia University in Malacca when he was still a lecturer, not into politics yet. So YB Dr. Mujahid is currently a member of parliament for Parit Buntal, Perak since 2008. He is the youngest son of Allahyarhum Tuan Guru Yusof Rawa, who was Pan-Malaysian Islamic Party as past president for 1982 until 1989. So very strong roots there. He has been member of past central committee since 2005. Upon chairing past national unity committee, he then took the initiative to establish past supporters club with the intention of engaging with the wider non-Muslim community. By May 2010, this club had evolved to be renamed the Past Supporters Congress in May 2010. He's also currently the chair of Working Committee on Law and Policy under the National Unity Consultative Council, NUCC, of which Kita is the secretariat. So I'd like now to open our session one to our first panelist, Prof. Dr. Aziz Bari, who will share with us social cohesion living through the historical context of a nation, the Malaysian journey. Over
to you. Thank you, Prof. A very good morning to all of you, friends. My presentation will be a very short one because I've got a very bad sore throat here, and what I will do with regard to the topic this morning is just to highlight some points that I think is relevant when it comes to with regard to the Constitution, because as far as I know, there is no such a thing such as social cohesion as far as the Constitution is concerned. And what we have in the Constitution is basically some provisions, some means to protect the rights, to keep the balance, and so on. Even though I think to some extent the provisions pertaining to Islam, pertaining to Malay language and so on, are there to give a certain amount of identity and continuity to this nation. Now, one of the problems mentioned in this small paper of this morning's program is about common citizenship. Now, this is one of the issues that was that had become a major problem during the negotiation. And it is interesting to note that it was one of the terms of reference assigned to the commission that was appointed in London Conference of 1956 to prepare draft and recommendation for the Constitution. But the problem is, of course, again, they did not quite clear on what was meant by this notion of common citizenship. And they also talk at some time about nationality. So you have this notion of citizenship as well as nationality. And to underline the important, or rather the crucial nature of this issue, it has been put as one of the provision that cannot be amended without the consent of the Council of Rulers. So this is where you find that sometimes, you know, when you have got problem, when you got tension and so on, police report has been done and so on, because to them this is something that cannot be touched. But at the same time, I think we have seen a few issues. For example, the working and the report or whatever of this Royal Commission of Inquiry in Sabah pertaining to citizenship has not been made public, and we don't know where it's is going. And given that citizenship is a matter that is so important as far as it is concerned to the Conference of Rulers, we somehow wonder as to why we have not been explained, or we have been told as to how, you know, these allegations about Bangladeshis, about foreign people getting my card and, you know, able to vote during elections. So I think this is a big question mark over the way we handle this question of citizenship, when other countries, you know, other part of the world have, I think, become more open when it comes to issues of citizenship, and we are still here being stuck in the old mode. So that's one thing, or rather a few things which I think I can say about this problem pertaining to citizenship or other, you know, common citizenship, which obviously presupposes a certain amount of assumption that we as citizens share the same rights, we are entitled to equal treatment and so on. Now, that brings me to the another problem pertaining to equal opportunities, which I think is also a problem, especially when we have got in the Constitution a provision like Article 8, which provides that every person has the right to equal protection of the law. So this is very important actually to know, because unlike other rights, so the treatment of equality is something that is available to everybody. Unlike, for example, the right to freedom of speech, peaceful assembly and association, these rights are only available to citizens. But when it comes to equality, I think it's important to note that it's available to everybody. I mean, citizen or otherwise. But the problem is, of course, the implementation. And the moment you look at the provision itself, you have got several or many exceptions with, you know. Do I have to make a note over here that sometime in 2002, I think, Parliament has made an amendment to make it provision, or rather to make it to prohibit gender discrimination in this country. I mean, to say that to a certain extent, this provision has been enlarged or has been expanded. Though I think we still have a problem. So recently in Selangor, when we have got a female adult put as MB designated, so many people, I mean, to certain people in certain groups were not up or were quite apprehensive about it. Probably, you know, in ignorance of the fact that we have actually amended the provision of the Constitution to have, or rather to perpetuate this gender discrimination. And I must say that in this respect, at least the government at the time, during Prime Minister Abdul, he was, I think, open enough to make this amendment. And it was actually one of the last few amendments made to the Constitution. Now it's difficult, or almost, I would say, impossible to amend the Constitution, because no one party has got to the majority in Parliament. So there you have got, that's the situation pertaining to gender discrimination here in this country. And of course, I have to say also that the court is also one of the culprits who somehow refused to put this into effect. And there have been, I think, several cases involving stewardess of the national carrier. And so it's quite strange, quite bewildering to come across federal court unable or unwilling to extend the right to equality to female stewardess in this respect. So I think the problem here is not the Constitution, but actually with the implementation agencies. Now, we also have problems with regard to freedom of religion. And this is something which I think has got to be seen in the light of Article 11, which to my mind is pretty okay, fine. Because it's basically an attempt to strike a balance between Muslim and a non-Muslim. This is also interesting to note, because unlike, as I said, right to freedom of expression and speech and so on, this religious freedom is granted to all. So irrespective of whether you are a citizen or otherwise, you are entitled to protection, or rather to have this religious freedom. Now, the problem to my mind is with regard to the implementation again. And with this regard, I think, again, the court has not been up to the mark, because, cases like what we have seen, the Herald issue and so on. So it is actually not quite in line with the Constitution, because I think from what we can gather from the entire provision as well as the structure itself, that the state is not, or I was not given the power. The state is not in a position to tell the non-Muslim in particular how to exercise their religion. Except, of course, subject to this rider, this condition that that freedom, that right should not be exercised in such a manner that it is against, or rather it is prejudicial to public order and so on. And of course the problem here is who to define. Is it the monopoly of the powers that be, or something that, that can be taken to court? So this is something that perhaps we can discuss. And I think in some respect, the position of Islam has been brought in incorrectly, rather not because to my mind the position pertaining to Islam is just to underline, to emphasize the history and nature of the nation. There's nothing to do with the, you know, because there have been the tendency to connect, or rather to bring in this provision to the point, to the extent that it regulates the way a non-Muslim, for example, exercise their freedom, or their right to freedom of religion. And I think this is quite not in line with the original intention of the drafter itself. Now, talking about social cohesion, I think it's also incumbent upon us to talk about Article 153, the special position of the Malays, as well as the native of Sabah and Sarawak. And although this is something that is apparently quite race-based, but I think the way the provision has been framed, we can see that it's not actually not necessarily that way, because you look at also the phrase, or the concept of the legitimate right, you know, of other races, the legitimate position of other races. We need to say that you can't just deny or take away the right or the position of other races just to give the Malays and the native of Sabah and Sarawak quote-unquote special position. And I think the problem here is that the constitution itself does not explain, does not define what this special position actually means. It's not special right anyway, and that's very clear. But some people are talking about, I think they have termed Article 153 as special rights. Not special rights, special position. That has never been defined. And if you go by the book, if you go by the Red Commission report itself, the original proposal was actually to have this provision only for 15 years. So their proposal, or their recommendation was that after 15 years, then Parliament should convene. Parliament should decide what to do, even though this was actually overruled by the white paper, a committee that was formed to go through, to scrutinize the proposal submitted by the commission. But the point is, I think there was a time frame, and I think now is almost six decades, and perhaps you got to think long and hard of what to do, given that they are still lagging behind. And I still remember reading through some of the points raised by the members of the Federal Legislative Assembly way back in 1957, before we got independent, that this may in the end become a handicap to the Malays themselves. This is something which I think we can discuss now. And I think even the sitting government has been several times, making it clear that they would like to review the position and so on. And even Dr. Mahathir, some years back, said that things like Malay Reserve, somewhat comparable to this famous Indian reservation in the States. That's pretty seditious, I think. I remember he said that way back in, I think, mid-90s. But looks like the old man can get away with anything he says. Even calling the Malays lazy and so on. Now, Ladies and gentlemen, I think the one thing that we can make use of under the Cohesion is the notion of the right of this freedom of speech and expression, right to peaceful assembly and right of association, even though unfortunately over the years it has been curtailed in many ways. And I think I can say that if the court has done its job as told, as recommended by the commission, we wouldn't have to have things like Soeakers, because I think it's also a burden to taxpayers, you know. And this is the problem. I think even though I've said in the opening that the council didn't really, or rather, does not really provide anything for us to, or rather, anything that is when we can specifically identify as ways and means to have social cohesion in this country. But I think there are provision in the council that can be used to promote that. But unfortunately, along the way, we have amended the constitution in such a way that we, I think, centralize powers. We tend to give more powers to the power that be, and we have got a provision like emergency that has been imposed on the states, which at some point of time they sought to assert their individuality, like Sabah and Sarawak, like Kelantan. You know, that is not quite in line with the original thinking when it comes to the constitution. So I think the problem is not the constitution, but I think it's our failure to make full use of the provision to have what is good, because obviously we can't expect the constitution to be perfect. And I think this is where the role, or rather the contribution from the executive, from the court, as well as from the citizenry, are very crucial to make sure that the constitution in its implementation in line with the needs of time, you know, because we have even older constitution like the Indian or the American one, but somehow this old constitution still able to move with times. So I think this is a problem, and I think it's our job as citizens of this country to make sure that the constitution is really relevant to the the problem that is social cohesion in this country. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving a new dimension to how the way we look at our federal constitution. Okay, we just reserve comments. We go on to our second speaker, that is Paul, please, sharing with us hate crimes, the UK journey.
Hello everyone, I'm Paul Giannasi. I'm a police officer from the UK. I've been asked to talk about the UK's experience in dealing with racism and other types of hate crime. What I should say from the offset is that I'm absolutely no expert on the issues as they affect Malaysia. I've now 2.5 days experience of the Malaysian experience, so I won't be seeking to make any judgments on local responses, good, bad or indifferent. What I'm going to do is to try and concentrate on where the UK has been in relation to this, and I will be bold and say that I think I'm going to provide evidence that says that the UK is amongst the strongest in its response in terms of legislation, in terms of encouraging the reporting of hate crime across the Northern Hemisphere, which is where I tend to sort of work in multi-state organisations. And we are there not because we are more virtuous, because we're more intelligent, or because we're more caring. We're there because things have gone so horribly wrong in the past, and people have died, and the ability of the state to protect its citizens has been so undermined because of the relationship with minority communities, in particular because of the sense of failings from the law enforcement agencies. And that's led to a series of high profile murders, of examination of the absolute core principles of policing, for instance, but also it's led to civil disorder, it's led to rioting in city centres. And the UK's population has changed dramatically over the last century. There is now a point where in the last census, London had 49% of its population described itself as not white British, or chose a category other than white British. So we're getting to the point where some of the major cities are so multicultural that that there is an extent that some of the right-wing commentators, some of the extremist commentators, some of the pseudo and openly racist commentators will say that the country has been overtaken. And that provides a ammunition for their argument that, in their words, the white working class man is being sold down the river for the sake of encouraging immigration, encouraging migration. So there are real challenges at a philosophical as well as a practical level. So I'm going to talk about how we approach hate crime. And what I should say in terms of the hate crime is that it isn't a universal concept. I'm not talking about that. There will be never a point, in my view, where academics have a common consensus about what is and what isn't hate crime. I would suggest that if you put five academics in a room and ask them to define hate crime, they come out with six definitions and two empty bottles of red wine in the UK experience. But it is an issue that we're not going to try and cover here. What I'm going to talk about is about how we define hate crime, about where we draw the parameters. And what I should say from the offset is this doesn't deny the existence of other types of hate crime or hate crime victims. It's really about what we measure. So in terms of measurement of hate crime, I'm just going to show this comparison from the, and this is the OSCE region, which has now got Mongolia added to it, but it's 57 states that you can see. And in the last data collection of 2012-13 for our data, the 2012 report, we recorded just under 50,000 hate crimes that the police recorded in the UK. By comparison, America, with seven times the population of the UK, recorded 7,200. So if you look at that, you would either say that we are 42 times more racist than America, or that there is some way that we are gathering more of the data of what happens. And having spent a lot of time in the US, I fairly confidently predict that we're not 42 times more racist than America as a population. So there is an issue about recognition. By comparison, the Russian Federation record just 460 hate crimes, and it gets worse. Italy, with a very similar demographic, very similar population, very similar challenges of migration, recorded just 71 crimes. And then it gets even worse. Greece is having a bad time, right? But Greece records one hate crime. And any of us who've seen the emergence of Golden Dawn in and around Athens and the neo-Nazi attitude of some of its people and the attacks on minority communities in and around Athens will say that that is a complete failure of the state to be able to recognise the problem. There is obviously, it's not wrong for me to comment on Greece, there are obviously politicians, there are obviously attempts at dealing with this issue. There has been some setup of some police monitoring groups. There is a lot of work gone on in the last few years in Greece. But it shows that the data is not being collated. And that could be because people are having confidence to tell the authorities, or it could be that the authorities are not recognising. But that somewhere along that conveyor belt, things are falling off. Okay. So within the UK, we do record, as I say, more than any other state, I think probably in the world, but certainly in the Northern Hemisphere. So we have a definition that says that any crime is a hate crime where the offender was motivated wholly or partially by hostility based on race, religion, sexual orientation, disability, and transgender. Or where the crime was committed and the offender demonstrated that hostility. So if somebody walks up and assaults somebody and walks away making racist comments about them, that would be treated as a hate crime in our definition. So we record, when we break down that 47,000, this is England and Wales, so Scotland isn't including this because they measure slightly differently, but within our data of 44,000 in England and Wales, around about 85% of those are race crimes. And we include, for race crimes, we include migration status, nationality, language, all of the things that we would broadly class as racist. So it's about 85% of the recorded hate crime. And you'll see that we record just over 4,000 sexual orientation hate crimes, 1,500 religious hate crimes. But actually, you've got to see that in the context of race, because many of our bigots in our our northern towns wouldn't know the difference between a Sikh and Hindu and a Muslim. They are all look like the same. So actually, somebody will be targeted because they come from a mosque or because they're wearing a niqab. but actually the language that will be used will be racist. That in the town where I used to work, the average racist would only be able to categorise four different types of ethnicity. You were either white British, you were Kosovan, you were Somalian, you were Pakistani or Chinese. And those were the sort of categories that you had to fall into. So anybody who was vaguely suntan would be a Kosovan until they were recognisable as a Somalian. So people categorised in it and they didn't have the nuance to be able to make just religious hostile comments, they used racist comments. So we have to see those two in some sort of linked capacity really. We record disability hate crime and this is a real emerging challenge, and I'll show you why in a short while. But there aren't, in the way that there are mission racists, people who are white supremacists to the core, there aren't mission disablers, for want of a better word. But there are so many traits of people being targeted because of disability, either because they slow the bus down because it's taken them a while to get onto the public transport, or because they've got a learning disability and they're being targeted, that there is an issue that we started to measure with some significance in the UK. So what I'm going to show you now is one of the things that we also did, which is really valuable to us in terms of setting policy, is look at victim surveys from a household capacity. So we survey 44,000 households in the UK about their experiences of crime in a survey that we call the Crime Survey of England and Wales. And it asks lots of questions about crime and asks about their experience of not only did they report crime, but did they suffer crime? And if they suffered it, what was the motivation behind it? What were the context of it? So one of the questions we ask on there is about whether it was a hate crime. And what it tells us is that it's quite a depressing picture, because as many as we record compared to other states, we're still looking at the tip of the iceberg. And many people don't have the confidence or the willingness to report to us. And the survey asked questions about why they didn't. And it was things like they didn't think the police would take it seriously, they didn't trust the police, they didn't think it was serious enough, they thought it would go away, they didn't want to make a fuss. There's all sorts of reasons. So in terms of race, that would suggest that your maths is probably better than mine, but that would suggest around about one in four hate crimes gets reported to us when it's race. And we still don't think that's equal. For a black family born, educated and living in this country, most would know of their right to be treated as a victim of race hate crime if they're subject to it. They may choose not to tell us for a number of reasons. But for a newly arrived asylum seeker or for a gypsy traveller Roma, they're not likely to have that same willingness to report. So it's probably greater in certain communities than others. So when we look down at the underreporting, there's a relative consistency there. We don't have data for transgender because there wasn't enough surveys done from transgender people to give us that information. But when you look at disability, we're saying that one in four, one in five crimes gets reported to us when it's race, but actually only one in 30 gets reported to us when it's disability. So there is this huge challenge that we have in relation to protecting disabled people and protecting their rights that we have to address. So, moving on. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some of the principles of the UK stance, because in such a short time, quite happy to answer questions about more specifics, but I'm going to make some global statements which sometimes people would want to challenge. In terms of a definition, we have a common definition of hate crime. And the important thing is that we recognise the term hate crime. It kind of stems from, it came to an emergence in the civil rights movement in America in the 60s, but was thought to have its roots in misogynistic violence earlier than that. But it's recognised internationally as a concept of hate crime. But what I think is really important, and what we stress to professionals and to victims, is actually we don't need to prove hatred. The only legislation that mentions hatred is the stirring up of hatred offence, and even then we don't need to prove that the offender hated, we need to prove that they were trying to stir up hatred in others. So what we have to prove is hostility, and hostility is a much easier emotion to grapple with for victims. It's about hostility includes unfriendliness, meanness. So it's a crime first. So fundamentally, we're talking about something which is on the statute of a crime, a criminal offence, where the offender is motivated, that adds that aggravating factor in terms of the approach to the victim and the nature of the offending. In that we have a human rights approach to hate crime. It is inclusive of everyone. So religious hate crime offence would include somebody targeted because they were an atheist. It would include sectarian violence. It would include people from one sect of another. It would include people who are sort of any given religion, even the ones that the mainstream religions would say were not real religions but cults. It doesn't protect any theology. There is no protection for Christianity. There is no protection for Islam. There's no protection for Judaism. There is a protection for all of our rights to practice and believe what we wish in freedom, freedom from targeted abuse. And that's a really fundamental principle for us. So it doesn't create any hierarchy. Now we have, in the UK, we have a policy that largely stems from an inquiry into the murder of a young black lad in London in 1993 called Stephen Lawrence. And it really, the inquiry really challenged the core relationship of the police and the service that it delivers to the community. And it was found massive sort of failings in the state's response to the rights of Stephen Lawrence and the rights of his family to be treated as a victim of race crime and the failings of the investigation. And it changed everything. It changed everything in the relation to how we investigate murders, into how we communicate and engage with communities, in how we deal with intelligence, and into how we deal with racism. So without going into too much detail, it kind of underpins it. And we, as I say, record those five strands of hate crime. We recognise that there are others. There are other people who suffer hate crime in things like caste-related tensions. But what we say is we have to draw a line on what we're going to measure. Okay. So why is it important? We know, and I'll give you the data in a short while, that it has a greater impact on the victim. Hate crime hurts more, and that's a core understanding of government as to why this is a priority. It's not universally accepted, but it's what government accepts. We know that it affects the wider community. An attack on a person from a given identity, whether it be race, religion, or sexual orientation, will have an impact on others who share that same identity. If we see that a person of my ethnicity is beaten up in a town, I'm unlikely to go back to that town so freely. I'm going to have a fear of crime. So it affects the wider community. They're called what some of the academics in the UK would call signal crimes. They're there to send a signal that you are not welcome as part of this community. So we know it has an impact on community cohesion and tension. It massively affects the confidence in the police, which affects the way we deal with all crime. It affects the way we deal with gang-related crime, violent crime, drugs-related crime. All of those things are impacted if the community feel that the police don't take this seriously. It prevents an escalation of seriousness. If we can deal with minor incidents, I would make a bold statement to say that we know of no case where somebody commits a racist murder as their first offence. There will always be an escalation of behaviour. There will be sort of language use. There will be minor assault. And if we intervene at those low levels, we may stop some of them tragedies ever taking place. In the UK, we have legal duties, which is under the Equalities Act and the human rights legislation. And these are, without going into them, legal duties that we have to protect. But the government priority is very much about under-reporting, and for the reasons I've just seen. So the victims survey, from the crimes survey, gives us certain information about victims' experiences of hate crime when they suffer it. And what this tells us amongst the various bits of data, I've picked out a few, which are that the hate crime victims are more likely to be repeat victims. It's more likely to be that they're repeated for crime over and over again. And you'll see the figures there. That's comparing the crime in general with the crime for hate crime. So, for instance, household crime, 36% of victims were repeat victims, where 27% of crime in general were repeat victims. But when you look at the low satisfaction levels, that's really quite damning. For me as a police officer, this is really hard to read. Victims are less likely to be satisfied with the police response, even though we are saying it's a priority. We are telling police officers that this is one of your priorities, and we genuinely mean that. There is genuinely a drive from the top to treat this seriously. And when you look at the respect, 76% of people felt that the police officer respected them, compared to 88% of crime in general. So you'll see that this, whether the police officers are intended, the message isn't necessarily going through, even if the police officers are trying to deliver that message of compassion and of empathy. And then this is really telling for me. This is why hate crime is so important. When you look at the impact, you look at those victims who said that they were emotionally affected, 82% of crime in general, victims said they're emotionally affected, but 94% of hate crime. But when you look at the bottom, when you look at the serious psychological harm, the anxiety and panic attacks and depression, victims are four times more likely to suffer those more serious psychological harms when they've been targeted in what they consider to be a hate crime. So really that is the compelling reason why this is a priority area for government. So we have legislation in the UK, we have rarely used but present incitement to hatred on the grounds of race, religion and sexual orientation. We only prosecute about five offences a year of racial hatred. We've had one conviction for inciting religious hatred and one conviction for inciting hatred on grounds of sexual orientation. And that's in 7 and 5 years that they've been on the statute book. And they are relatively rarely used. And they're safe for people who are literally trying to stir up hatred. So they're the people like the white supremacists who are trying to create race war, trying to create race tension. The cornerstone, if you like, of the legislation is this enhanced sentencing. So what Section 145 and 146 of the Criminal Justice Act do is they instruct the court, so they don't give the court the option. They order the court that where they're satisfied that evidence has been provided that the offender was motivated wholly or partially by hostility, or that they demonstrated a hostility based on those five characteristics, then the court must enhance the sentence and they must say in open court that they've done so. And that's really important because it sends the clearest message. And G. Walker, who was the mother of a lad murdered in 2007, openly and publicly said that the statement of enhanced sentencing for the offenders who killed her son was the clearest indication to the black community that the state was there to protect them and not to oppress them. And it was a clear message to other offenders as well. So it's really the cornerstone of our legislation. But there has recently been a Law Commission review which is looking at hate crime legislation, looking to see whether there's any gaps, and that's reported fairly recently to government, and government hasn't responded yet. So I'm going to talk about some of the future challenges. So what amongst the challenges we have, that we have relatively robust data in terms of recorded crime, in terms of prosecuted crime, but we don't have very good application data of enhanced sentencing. We know that people have talked about education and the importance of education, and we've started to work with educators to try and provide resources for teachers to be able to deal with it. So I'm just going to talk about, I'm going to move on from this because I realise I'm taking too much time. I'm just going to talk about how hate crime and the reporting of hate crime, so the media response and the internet response, if you like, plays such an important part. What you see here is those two clips from newspapers, and they are about the reporting of an elderly war veteran, as he's described, Walter Chamberlain, a 74-year-old man, who was beaten up by four young Asian, Pakistani Asian lads in a town, and he was robbed. They were robbing him for his money. He fell to the ground and suffered quite horrific facial injuries, which you may just be able to make out in the picture. But the reporting in the media was really important because what they reported, and he was adamant that this wasn't a race hate crime. It would be seen as racism if it was racist, but he was adamant that it wasn't. But the papers reported it as beaten to a pulp for being white. OAP 76 attacked in Asian no-go area. And what that did is it stirred up a hostility in the white community and those disaffected white communities that said that here is an example of young Asian men beating white people up, beating elderly white people up. And what that brought around is an attack on a community where it happened from a bunch of white supremacist football hooligan types. And they attacked and they turned over cars and they set fire to buildings and they beat people up in a coordinated hate crime attack that led to civil disorder because the community were fearful, the community turned out to protect themselves. And it brought around a series of violent, racist public order situations which lasted for many months and took and cost something like £10.3 million worth of damage alone, 300 police officers seriously injured. So not having grappled with the hate crime in the first instance, not having had the intelligence to allow us to intercept, not allowing because it's a free media, but not recognising the impact of the media coverage of this and the negativity of bad media coverage showed us that actually if we don't deal with those things in a proactive way, dealing with the consequences will be far more tragic for us. So I'm going to move on. I'm just going to go past this because I was going to talk about the internet. I'll just mention the internet has become, in a phrase, the cause of and the solution to every problem that we have at the moment. Everything that manifested itself on the streets, in terms of communications in cafes, in terms of communication in media, now takes place on the internet, and it multiplies it and it amplifies it, and it makes it more difficult to monitor and to manage. And one of the American websites called Stormfront, which is the website of the Ku Klux Klan, is probably thought to be one of the longest running internet websites in existence. But it didn't really cause that much problem because the only people who found it in the olden days were the people who either were members of it or who were observing it. But the Web 2.0, the bit that made the internet interactive, the bit that provided Facebook and Twitter and Google and those sorts of things, provided an opportunity for people to be anonymous, to be interfering in locations that they're thousands of miles away, to be stirring up hatred, to create a persona which allows them to have far greater impact. And dealing with that and dealing with the consequences of that is provided a challenge to governments that we are incapable of dealing with unilaterally. There is almost no way that any one single government anywhere in the world will solve this problem, because if we close down behaviour and the situation in the UK, it will just move elsewhere, but it will still affect the UK. So I'm just going to finish, if I may, I'm just telling you about one of the examples of the resources that we provide. Because if you think that target for me as the leader of the government programme is to increase reporting, that in itself sends a really important message. Politicians are confident enough to be able to say, we know this is a problem, we're not denying the problem exists, but actually we know it's a lot greater than we say. So to have politicians coming to me and saying, I want crime rates to go up, is quite a challenge for people to grasp. It's a brave move. That politicians like to go into elections saying that they brought crime down. So to say that they want it to go up is for me a transparency and a bravery of all of our political leaders of successive parties, that it really helps to deal with this situation. So one of the ways we do this is through, it also allows people to report online. It allows victims to report online anonymously if they choose to do so. If they don't trust the police, they can report it anonymously. It allows civil society groups to report on behalf of victims, where the victim will approach a local civil society group but wouldn't approach the police. So it provides that information. It has around about 10,000 visits per month of visitors who visit an average of 7 pages. So it is very well used. That's something like 3 times as many as the number of crimes we recovered. It had 3,500 crimes last year reported through the online portal. So it provides a resource that is seen as valuable. And what it's supplemented by is a social media presence. So we reach out to victims through social media so that we can target, if we know there is a rise of crime against Somalian refugee victims, then if we know that there is a internet usage amongst that group, we can target them because the algorithms of Facebook and Google mean that we can send adverts to them in a targeted way which reaches the audience but doesn't cost as much as you would imagine. And it provides opportunities for us to send messages about reassurance, about cohesion, about the sorts of things, that messages that we want to get, to encourage that reporting. So it has mobile phone applications that go with it so that people can have this on the mobile phone. So I won't go through that, but that's the result of one of the specific pieces of work we did to target people who were deaf, who use sign language as their primary communication. And we provided a video, and then we obviously needed them to see the video. So what we did with that is provided this advertising campaign. And what it shows is that basically, out of 16,000 people who were identified as BSL, British Sign Language users, 14,300 of them got to see that advert 125 times each. And most importantly, 688 downloaded the video, which was around about 1% of the number of people on the census who said that they were British Sign Language users. About 10%, I should say, sorry. So it provides that opportunity for us to go out and proactively target victims to encourage them. But it also allows us to target offenders, to send them messages that says that we won't tolerate this behaviour. It gives us opportunities. So I'll stop there. Apologies if I've overstretched my 15 minutes, but I'll stop there and we'll be happy to answer any questions. So thanks for your time.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera. Yang saya hormati Dr. Ong selaku moderator kita pada pagi ini, yang berusaha Profesor Aziz Bari yang memberikan gambaran tentang peranan memahami kelembagaan kita. Seterusnya saudara Paul Giannasi yang did I get the pronunciation right? Giannasi that shared experience, the UK experience, and that will be coming very handy to us. Here we are just talking having the law. There they are talking about the problem of the law. So I think this is good experience where we can learn from the UK. And my presentation today, I think most of you have heard it in other places. But before I start with the slides in front of you, I just like to share a little bit of experience that I had in Melbourne. I just came back from Melbourne, arrived today at 7:05. They have this program called Living the Malaysian Dream. It was organized by the Malaysian student there, Malaysian student organization. So they invited me. And the topic is very interesting, where it's like everyone wants to have a dream about Malaysia and living with that dream. So they were showing some videos on what other students take on having a Malaysian dream. So some of them said having a Malaysian dream means that I would not want to be identified as Chinese or as Indian Malaysian or as Malay Malaysian. I would want to be Malaysian first. And then there were others who said that living in a Malaysian dream means that I can get scholarship equally without having to differentiate Bumi Putra or non-Bumi Putra. Some said that I would like to have a Malaysian dream where I can get job easily. And so when I came to the floor to start my speech, I started off with this. I said something like this. I too share the same dream of the younger generation. But I would want to dream something that Malaysia would do without, rather than I would want to dream what Malaysia would do with. Because if you start to talk about what Malaysia would do with unity, cohesion, whatever names you want to name it, your tolerance, respect, now that will be the result. But what about looking into what are the obstacles, what are the impediments that will stop from having all these impediments? So I would choose a different kind of dream. I would choose a dream Malaysia without. And I started off with one thing or one value that I dream of, a Malaysia without prejudice. That's one thing for sure. Because talk about unity, talk about cohesion, at the end of the day, if Malaysians still live in prejudice, then there is no point or even having a law for that. So this negative value of prejudice should be a premonition concern that we want to live one day without such prejudice. Number two, I said I would want to see Malaysia without racism, because racism is the great obstacle for us to unite. The academics say looking others into the ethnocentric perception. I mean, I look my friend, a fellow Malaysian, in my ethnocentric point of view, as a Malay, for example. An Indian look into a Malay, in their ethnocentric perception. And finally, we get to see this generalization thing. And you say a Melayu, oh, these are the guys who get all the Bumiputra status, all the scholarship. You know, I'm a Melayu, I never get a scholarship, I'm very proud of it. Until my PhD, I never get one stamp from the government. And I'm a Malay. Then you say, oh, Indian, oh, Indian tadi, mabuk lah, you boleh mai ke pukul 4, contohnya. But that's not all the Indian. A Chinese, oh, Chinese always dominating everything. And one day they're going to take over our land. So the moment you say Chinese, oh, these are the people who are going to take our land. You know, the Malay would have that perception. Now that's terrible. Because I would believe that if everyone looks into this perception or perspective, then definitely racism will have its way easily in our country. And it is rising, unfortunately. I would want Malaysia with that, without that. And then I also say that I would want Malaysia without extremism. And I said this many times in the International Law Conference, some of you attended. I said I will fight against extremism, whoever they are. Whether they are Hindu extremism, Malay extremism, Chinese extremism, Muslim extremism, Christian extremism, Buddhist extremism, I will fight them to the end. Because this is not the value, the Malaysian one. Extremism was never the value. You may say that when I talk about extremism, it always relates to Islam. Basically, I think, or to be fair, that Islam is not an extremist religion. You might find a Muslim who is extreme, yes. But Islam on the whole is not an extremist religion. You have Christians. You have Christian extremists, yes, you do have Christian extremists. But that does that mean that all Christians are extreme? No, definitely not. See, you really have to be very careful in generalizing terms, in generalizing the faith, in generalizing the race. Because you will always have a rotten egg in one basket. You always have a rotten durian, you know. Every time when you look at the durian, you will have one durian that is rotten. And you cannot say the whole durian is rotten, they are very nice. You know? So even durian can unite us together, actually. I would like to add that to Professor a speech today, this morning. So I started off with this, and it was very interesting to note here that all the students, which comprises of different race, were there to share with us, the young generation. And I would say that is the voice of the young generation. And I would agree very much that whatever you hear in the news, whatever you hear in the media, and I will come to touch on that, as much as my friend Mr. Paul has touched on how media played their role, negatively or positively, I would say that the issue of the rising of racism or extremism actually do not represent the majority of the Malaysian people, nor the majority of any political parties. It only represents few guys who think they're so great and representing, they think that they are representing the country. And the worst part is that they get the media attention. We don't get media attention. Is there any media today? Talking about social cohesion? It would be very boring to write such a report, wouldn't it? It doesn't sell. But when you say something like this, there is a convention against Chinese in Malaysia. Ah, then the whole country will come and give that focus, you know? Why? Because there's a sensation to that. Okay, so here I don't see any media. I don't see any media covering and saying they are a group of nice people who represent the moderates, who wants to see the country move forward, they're all smiling and hugging one another. That doesn't sell, man. You know, I need something, man. I need something. You know, like the Superman, Clark, you know, the, hey, Parker, I need something, the Spider-Man. I need some news, man, so it can sell, you know. These news don't sell, unfortunately. Okay? And that's not good, actually. Now, when we talk about that, the young generation, the aspiration, we had to, in a sense, also be very honest and true. To, as far as the ground is concerned, you see, we might be having a conference here, talking about all this, and on the ground, I think the majority are ignorant of all what we are doing here, right? And I think also that on the ground, you still have this innocent negative perception on the people on the ground, the general people, still having this negative perception about Chinese, about Malay, about Indian, the Indian community in itself, the Chinese community in itself, and the Malay community in itself. So I do not want to blame any race here, because I believe it is the value that is within that particular race that is dominating them. It's not about Chinese, it's not about Indian, it's not about Malay. Okay? So basically, there will be a counter argument on whatever I say about all this. Okay? They would say that, yeah, I agree with you, but it will take some time. Because the public doesn't understand. You know, because if you want to come up with something drastic, and then there will be some repercussion to it. And that is how they make that excuse until 60 years from then and until now, the same excuse. So, I am on the belief that you don't have to have all Malaysian 23 million understand that we come up with something new. I don't think that is the realistic approach to this. So, I would say I'm on the belief that I don't believe altogether that law can solve the problem. Okay, just like maybe I think my good friend Mr. Paul also agreed that law doesn't solve all the problem. You should have other factors that come together with it. Because there are even Timothy Shah, I think, one of the American researchers who made the research on the Muslim countries, said that the more law you have, hitting the racial and religious relationship. But I tend not to agree with that totally, because the issue of the law is not just about the substance of the law. The law can be very good. The law can be, very sound when trying to address such issues. But then you have another big problem. The judiciary is another problem that we have. This is our concern. You have a good law, but you have a terrible judiciary. Now what are you going to do about that? As been mentioned by Professor Dr. Aziz Bari, who is also the victim of Sedition Act. I mean, if a professor is a victim of Sedition Act, I cannot imagine more than that. You know? I mean, a politician can get the Sedition Act, but a professor? Okay. I believe the soft cultural approach. And it's important that we start to have this approach now in place. Number one, building humanity as a uniting factors. You know, at the end of the day, who cares whether you're an Indian, who cares whether you're a Malaysian, or whether you're British, whether you're American? At the end of the day, every one of us is human. And that is very important. This humanistic approach needs to be, you know, understood by our society today. And it is strange that this has become a joke in our country. When you find or when you encounter an accident, the moments that come up from your mouth, eh, siapa kena? Melayu ke Cina ke? India ke kena? I mean, what is so important whether he's a Malay, a Chinese or an Indian? He's a human and he is in dire need of your help now. Go and help him. You know, you don't go and that person is dying and you ask him, hey, you Chinese? Eh, you Melayu ke? Like if a Malay go and help him, if he's a Malay, then I will quickly attend to you. Or if he's a Chinese, let me see if there's any Chinese, you know, he will come and help you. I'm exaggerating, it doesn't happen. Don't quote that. But what I'm trying to say is that sometimes this is the culture we have. You see, we need to be more human in our relationship. We need to be, like just now, I heard the question from the floor saying that if a non-Muslim give assalamu alaikum, what's wrong with you saying alaikum salam? The Quran said, فَإِذَا حُيِّيْتُمْ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنِ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا فَإِذَا حُيِّيْتُمْ بِتَحِيَّةِ. If you are being greeted with a blessing, a peace blessing, and then فَحَيُّوا, say the same to him or to her, أَوْ رُدُّوهَا, or something like that, better or something like that, then what is the problem here? This is the problem of Malay Islam. Not Islam, Islam. This is the Malay Islam. And this is where we get into trouble. I will come to that actually. That was actually internalizing the purpose of religion. Why is religion so important in our life? Religion is so important in our life because it also relates to our relationship with others. No religion can tell you you have the right to become racist because God says so. No religion tells you that you can hate others. Even if you are on the right track and you believe you are on the right track, definitely you have to believe when you are on the right track. If you are a Muslim, how can you say, I think I'm on the right track, it's okay lah. I said, because you also have religion, different religion, never mind lah. I didn't think that's a spirit and that's not what I've been preaching for. A Muslim should believe in his or her faith and cannot say that we are the same. If Christians and Muslims are the same, you go and create another faith. Don't say I'm a Muslim, don't say I'm a Christian. But the issue is that being a good Muslim doesn't stop me from respecting other faith because my God says so. I'm not doing this politically because I want votes from the Chinese. I'm not saying this politically because I want votes from the Hindus, from the Hindu followers. But I'm saying it because my God says so. My God says, وَلَا تَصُّبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَصُّبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوَانًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Do not curse other gods than your God, because they shall curse your God back. Why? Because I have created them within their faith and their belief that they think they are right. It is not of us to say you are wrong or you are right. My God is better than your God. Because if that was the case, then the poor will be in charge. This is the signs of respect that Islam teaches us. So internalizing your own faith is very important. A Christian should know what Christianity is all about. A Muslim should know what Islam is. Not Islam, Melayu, Melayu, Islam, no. What Islam has taught us by the Prophet, peace be upon him. Interfaith dialogue and conferences, I think that has been done and is ongoing. Practical interfaith social activities. Come on, let's not just be formal having dialogues and interfaith talk. Let's go and play soccer. The Christian young club and the Muslim young club. Let's go and play soccer. Let's kick one leg, another leg and bang one another. Let's go fishing. Let's go having picnic together. You bring your food, I bring my food. You know? Let's go and see, let's go to the cinema together. See good movies, man. I think if people start to do that in a recreational way, in a very informal way, that's where the interaction, begin. Your sister, moderator, Dr. Ong, was with me during our training for the voluntary force. That is Watania. You know, we went into the jungle for 1 week for the training. I was an officer, an officer then. Now no more, I've already stopped the voluntary squad. I was guiding her sister at night because she had to go to the toilet in the jungle. In the jungle, no toilet like this, you know, in the jungle. You know? And when I had to go to the toilet, she would take care of me. Hey, you finish up, you finish up. You can verify that. What's the problem, man? Ong is a Chinese, I'm a Malay. We went to jungle together. We went training together. And we were good friends. Until now. Normally I know, I thought she was off. They look, resemble the same. So what I'm trying to say is, why is there not any physical interaction, something that could bind us together? And I think this is the challenges that we should be looking into. Cordial meeting of religious leaders. I mean, if religious leaders meet in a cordial manner, thanking one another for playing your role into uniting the Malaysia through our own faith, I think that would be very good. And that's just what I did. When the when the Bishop Sebastian was appointed as a bishop, I went and congratulated him, even give him cake, and say, I hope your appointment as bishop can help foster unity in this country. You know, if a Mufti of Penang had been appointed newly, one Christian leaders go and say, congratulations, you know, what's wrong with that? It takes both ways, not just a Muslim going to Christian, man. Christian can come and see the leaders and talk about matters that involve the public importance. Interfaith sports, as you mentioned, research academic grants. That would be Dr. Danielson Field. Then there's another approach. There's another approach. The other approach is through the constitutional framework, through the legal framework. You have our constitutional. You have our constitution. Our constitution is already there. It's nice, and I wouldn't say it's perfect, but it's actually give already on how to relate in this diverse environment. And I would like to stress here that when our forefathers founded this nation, they are very clear, or they were very clear the moment they founded, or the intent of this nation. They founded this nation and they say this nation is not just going to be democratic, but it is a diverse and multi-race and cultural and religion. It was there all along. Don't come and tell me, I think our forefathers had done something wrong, now we had to put them back in track. There is nothing wrong with them. They knew what Malaysia would be. Something is wrong with us because we did not put them, or we did not put the intent of the nation back on its position. Thank you, I know I have. Then, leaders can mediate on issues, political will, and then the existing laws and policy, which is very, very important. I think Chiwi will talk about the National Harmony Bill, which we are now making it, you know, inroads trying to get it through the table, you know. Conflicts and problems. You have politicians who exploit things, and I've said them many, many times, they are the main culprit of all this. You know, I hope I'm not one of them. They exploit things for their own purposes, for their own votes. You know, if I go to the Malay area and say something like, kita semua sama, kita tak boleh beza, and then maybe I will get less vote next time. But my point is that wherever you go, to whatever community, whether they are Chinese, or they are Malay, or they are Indian, you should say that we are all Malaysian. We must give our hand to our fellow Malaysian. Now, if someone can say that, and it become a culture to every politician, I think we will have a better politician in our country. Media manipulation has been mentioned by our friend, the rise of extremism, ignorance of one's faith, and the way forward is to have a statement rather than a politician, because I said this so many times, politician thinks of the next election, statement thinks of the next generation. Political parties must reform to be more inclusive. Yes, I know then there will be a question from the floor. What about PAS? What are they going to do? I know you're good, but when I look into PAS, they're not moving that way. What can I say? You're free to say anything. But give us the chance to reform. PAS Baru and Rejuvenasi PAS. I've written two books on that, you know, and I don't get popular for such writing. But I am I'm convinced that the political parties must reform to be more inclusive. More media freedom with responsibility to enhance harmony. building culture of humanity and caring society, treating religious incitement and hatred as a crime. That was just what Paul has shared with us. It's a crime. Treating religious and fight and support movement against racism and extremism. Support Komas, because they are on this track to turn Malaysia into a moderate country. Support other groups, what? Negara Ku, support them. And inshallah, in the coming month, there will be a new group, Malaysian Against Racism, which I will try to hit the campaign. Support them. Why? When everyone starts to support moderation, then moderation becomes the language of the day. Don't come and say, I believe in you, but you know lah.
The question first to Professor Bari. I just want to confirm that you actually say about Article 11, freedom of religion, apply to citizen as well and non-citizen. That means all races, including the Malays, right? And thank you very much. And to Datuk Mujahid, there'll be more questions. So what do you think about that, Datuk, that the freedom of religion actually applies to the Malay? And you are talking mostly about other races just now, about other religions, but you fail to mention about the Malays. You see, I'm a Malay, okay, but I'm being prejudiced by people in past, people who are extremely religious, who think they are religious lah. I've been treated, you know, less than a human. I'm not being, they think that I'm a murtad. So actually being a Malay in this country is, we are the most oppressed race in Malaysia. And because it's, and you see, you're, you know, I agree that political games and exploitation, this is why we do not need political parties based on religion, religious you know, foundation. Because you are going to use religion as your political achievement. You will tell the Malays this is the way forward, you know, and the way forward is to be more Islamic, and to be Islamic is your view of what Islam is. I'm not talking about you per se, but no, you may be, yes. If I ask you about freedom of religion towards the Malay, I'm sure you will say, you won't actually give me a direct answer. I'm very sure you will just beat around the bush, okay? So, and you say, is religion important in life? I disagree with you. There are many people who don't believe in any religion, but they lead a very good life. So please, have respect to people who do not believe in religion. So actually religion, we must separate religion from politics. Then we can move forward. For as long as Malaysia stick mixing religion and politics, we are going to be forever in this dilemma. Forever we'll be in this hating each other. So to YB Mujahid, please leave past and join another party that do not have any religion base.
I'm Ihsan from Project Dialog. Okay, my question is rather short. Okay, we know that problem, the issue is unity now, one of the reasons focusing on matters into religious issues. One thing we may say that, okay, we are all right, we are the one pushing for unity, but we also know that main challenges is also coming from institution, in particular religious institution, Islam in particular. Okay, one thing that we know that for them, we say that the problem is actually coming from, maybe coming from people who assume that they want unity, because they also say that they are also right. Okay, so one way to overcome this challenge is when it comes to engagements. Could engagements be done with religious institutions in a certain way, and could this be the way forward, especially coming from the experience from Dr. Mujahid as a political party representing the Islamic party?
Daniel Lowe from the Prime Minister's Office and Special Officer to Dr. Paul Lau on Human Rights. I just question to all the panelists. We've been talking about unity and inclusiveness and all these very large and overarching concepts. And one of the feelings which I get, not only from the panelists, your presentations, but also from the floor in some ways, is that we seem to be struggling with making the issue of unity very exciting to the mass. YB Mujahid talked about, when we talk about disunity, when we have conflict, that seems to draw people's attention. And if you want to be a moderate, it kind of gets boring and people fall asleep. I was just wondering whether the if that is true, and whether the panelists can speak about or share whether what ways you could to move, or how we could talk about unity towards a better tomorrow, in the sense of not unity for unity's sake, so to speak, or for example, in the area which I'm working more actively in, human rights for human rights' sake, but what would be the tomorrow look like, and how would we bring those, that issue of unity, back to everybody's life in a real way? Maybe to phrase the question another way, how would you perhaps mainstream the question of unity? So it's like a question, how would you mainstream human rights issues? Thank you.
Everybody, but I think I need to make it very clear that freedom, or rather liberty, does not mean free for all. I mean freedom under the law, you know. And the law has got its own way of defining liberty and rights, and that is something which I think you can check in the judgments, in the statute and so on. As to question how to move forward, I think speaking on from the constitution point of view, I think it's quite simple, though this is not easy to do. It requires a lot of political will. To me, it's very simple. You just make sure that the constitution is really the benchmark, which means that all laws that are against human rights, all laws that are undemocratic and so on, must go. Very simple. And I think you have been talking and telling this, umpteen times, and there's no need for us to repeat the types and the sort of laws that must go and so on. So in other words, it's quite simple, because now we have got the constitution as the benchmark, but we have got things like the Sedition Act, Official Secret and so on, which I think not only the problem is not only the law, but also the question of selective prosecution.
Thanks. I think the only question I was competent to answer is part of the last one, and what is government's role in relation to this issue of unity. And I think one of the things that we've kind of discovered is what we wouldn't necessarily want is a homogenous society where everybody looks, says and thinks the same. And actually there are two roles for government. One is in terms of leadership through education, in terms of agreeing freedoms of media, but trying to encourage a collaborative approach where people use the media and their rights responsibly. But I think the issue is, for us, the goal is to celebrate difference. So we want societies to be identifiable as being part of Britain and what it stands for. But actually would like to be able, for people to be able to celebrate their difference, whether it be religious or whether it be ethnic. And I think one of the ways that government can really do that is to provide the foundations that says that this is a universal society, that everybody has the same respect, regardless of their origins, their history and their beliefs. So if we have that universal respect that is underpinned, people have the confidence to go to the state when that right to live in freedom is impinged, then really that's the sort of main thing that governments can do, in my view, to try and encourage and engender that behaviour. So I think that was probably the only point I even understood, was probably able to comment on.
Thank you very much. I was expecting such questions from the floor. The same question. Now, but this, seriously, I think this is an issue. Your good self has already said it about religion and politics. But my problem is that being a Muslim, after understanding the long history of Islam, having the one of the great civilization among other civilization that existed, have lived peacefully in a diverse environment, not just saying one particular or two, three particular race, but they were everywhere in this continent, and yet they are the best, I would say, way comparing to other civilization on dealing with diversity. I can't run away from the fact that historical, because that is why in the Islamic jurisprudence, you have this notion about dealing with the non-Muslim. Now you might ask me, why are you saying dealing with a non-Muslim? Well, that was the norms of the day. They were Muslim and they were non-Muslim. And those who were non-Muslim as the norm of the day were considered as the enemy because they were fighting against Islam and Islam was fighting against them. So there had to be some sort of demarcation and how they were treated. And this is in the history, my dear. You cannot lie in the history. And you have this concept of guarantee and protection, the dhimma, the guarantee and the protection, where the guarantee and the protection was the best model in the Islamic civilization had, where they protected the Christians, they protected the minorities then in the Islamic dominated area. And the best model that you will find also in Sicily there were the Islamic authority there, but the majority were Christians. And they accepted living together, peacefully coexistence, without having any animosity or without having any hatred to one another. Now, having said that, my dear, I'm not trying to bring all those books and say, come on, let's do it today. You know, I don't think that is the spirit. The spirit is that with all these assets that we had, thousands of years, I'm not going to let it go like that. I would want to see how it could be applied in the contemporary world, within the contemporary setting, and within the contemporary structure that we have. And I can't say much about other countries because I come from Malaysia. I have this constitution in me. I have Islam as the background of this country, which is the identity that they want to preserve. I have Islam as the main proponent in creating the country. I just cannot deny all that fact. Now my problem is, how are you going to portray Islam? What Islam are you talking about? Then we have to debate. What Islam says about human rights? What Islam says about other relationship with other race? What Islam says about constitutionalism? What Islam says about citizenship? And I think there are books all over. And what I'm saying is that today, I understand Islam in the contemporary world, and I cannot disassociate myself with Islam, because Islam for me is a way of life that when I become a politician, I should be a politician who is guided by the principle of Islam. And that is nothing wrong with that. I wouldn't want to have someone, and I'm not saying those who are without religion. You see, this is the problem. When I say that, you say, are you saying that those without religion has no principle? I did not say that. I did not say that. If you think without having a religion can have, or can you can have principle with that, fine. Then influence others and say that without religion you can be good. Okay. That's another option. You see? So whatever you believe doesn't mean that it will represent the whole of the society. You see? And whatever I say here doesn't mean that it represents the whole of my society. It's a matter of where do we stand in the values of respecting other people's rights. It is a matter of where you stand in giving rights to others. Now, as far as the religious freedom is concerned, religious freedom in our country is enshrined in Article 11, but limited in Clause 4, saying that you cannot propagate that other religion than Islam. Now, don't ask me why it is like that. Everyone must discuss about it and talk about it. That's number one. Number two, Islam, as far as religion freedom is concerned, has many books written on it. When there are this, the law of apostasy or the ridda, when someone profess other religion and leave Islam, there are two meaning to that. One meaning, this is the scholars. I'm sharing you what religious freedom means in Islam, because you were asking that question. One is that someone changed their religion for the sake of changing it out of his own conviction. He believed that other faith is better. This is called riddah mujarrada. Purely leaving the religion because he believes, he's convinced that the time is up. He's convinced that... I'm sorry, you raised a very important... Hang on, let me finish. You talk, I talk, we listen. Yes, this is how we do things here. What it is that, yeah, you have to accept that is the point. Riddah Mujarrada is those who want to leave Islam out of his conviction. He believes Christianity is better. He believes other religions are fine. Then you have another one. They call it Riddah Muharaba. Or you leave Islam with animosity, hated to Islam, and joining other force to stop Islam. That's another issue, my dear. That's a totally another issue. You have to clear the definition between both of that. And this is how Islam understands the religious freedom. Thank you very much. About the fasting, I think as far as my party is concerned, you know now that every party should reform. And I'm telling you that not to say that I'm going to leave the party, I will make sure the party is reformed.
Why would you be so happy to give us statistics that the UK is a champion of hate crime? You know, that's really strange. Most governments will hide it and say we only have 4, but you were very openly shared 47,000. That's a bit strange, eh? Coming from Malaysia. The second one is, has the law been effective in changing attitudes or slowing down hate crime? And how do you handle your history of Christian history, UK being Christian background, and then is that giving groups advantage, superiority with minority groups there? How is that handled in terms of hate speech?
Thank you. Presentation that there should be more religious dialogue, more religious meeting between leaders, and more activities that is not too much structured and formal. There can be other activities between different faith. Eliminating poverty, for example, eliminating poverty across all race and faith, and also education to the poor. Together, all the three religion work together. I think this is part of what you wanted, and I'm pleased that there are people now, groups who are working towards that, and we should support also that sort of activity. Thank you very much.
It requires an element of bravery. But with any problem, whether it's a personal problem or a national problem, the first step towards dealing with it is recognising it. And I think it's required a bravery that has been there from successive governments. So this isn't about one government sort of criticising the other. There has been that common view that this is a pervasive problem which brings around larger problems of terrorism, larger problems of community disorder if we don't deal with them. And we've had to really examine ourselves in the UK to get to that point where politicians are prepared to say we actually want more crime, even though we stand out against others as really high numbers. But I think once you accept that, once it's almost like learning to swim and holding on to the side, and actually you've got to have enough confidence to let go at some point. And when you do let go, it's liberating, and suddenly you start to deal with the issue. There are reports that I've seen coming out of America saying don't go to the UK because you'll be beaten up before you get off the plane, effectively. And there are people who misconstrue that data maliciously or well intended. So it requires a nuance and it requires an explanation. But I think when we talk to some of the established communities, and I'm recently sort of met with representation from the Jewish community, who would say that the fact that there is this transparency over the acceptance of the problem gives people confidence. And when the EU Fundamental Rights Agency, which kind of explains what it does, examined the Jewish community across Europe, the community in the UK were far more likely to report crimes if they happened, but far less fearful of crimes than in other countries. So I think for me it's kind of like the maturity of the relationship between the two, but it requires real bravery from political leaders to be that one who says we're going to make things appear worse to make them better. But I think it's really important, and for us, from my observance of government, it's one of the strongest foundations for the policy. So hopefully that answers.
Thank you very much to Paul. Thank you very much to our three speakers and also to participants. I'm sure many of you have some burning questions. I myself have burning questions also to ask, but we don't have the time to ask. But allow me to just make a very brief conclusion, if I may. Just taking off from Dato' Mujahid's point, saying that we need to be more human and to transcend culture. We each have our own cultures. Culture is very important because it allows us to predict what will happen and to regulate our behavior. But then it's also like therein lies the problem, because we have our own cultures. We are cultured person. We are kita beradat. But because we are so focused on our culture is right and is the only way, and in the process we become biadab. No, we become non-cultured. Because why? We are focusing on what is right for me. I'm a Buddhist, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Malay, I'm a Chinese, I'm a Kadazan. And so I do what I think is right. And whatever else other people do is wrong. But we are having an interrelationship here. We are social beings. And how is it that we can build a relationship with other people who are different from us? And that is what we have to transcend culture and go into the realm of civilization. We have to be civilized people and not cultured people just. Yeah? And also the next point is to take home, is to reflect on this. We are so focused on the container. What is it that we put into this container? How big is our container? How beautiful is our container? So we have the Islam container, the Buddhism container, the Christianity container, the Malay, UK container, England container, Malaysian container. But we are less focused, we are putting less emphasis on the content. And if we are so focused on the container, we'll be contained. There'll be containment. Not dalam rangka, kerangka itu, ya, kepompong itu. And we are not focused on the content, and therefore, do you think, ladies and gentlemen, we will have contentment? If you're so focused on the container, and being so content, we won't have contentment. And here we are talking about peace. We want equality, we want justice. All of us share that kind of human values. But if we as human beings, as cultured people, we are so focused on the culture of our own and on the container, I don't think we could achieve that contentment as our vision to have a nation that is at peace with one another. Thank you so much for listening. I apologize for the time management. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.